Welcome to my presentation with open source intelligence data in cyber threat intelligence for a common purpose. That is a topic which I have done in the last semester during my master's studies at the Friedrich Alexander Universität as part of the master seminar IT Security Conference. We had to write 10 pages of, for a research paper of a pre-chosen topic. And during the long night of sciences, I have seen a presentation with open source intelligence, a little bit hardware hacking, and I thought about whether we can use it also for protecting enterprise environments. Therefore, I wrote a paper about open source intelligence with cyber threat intelligence for enterprise IoT, but you can reuse it everywhere. Therefore, I said that, okay, I want to use this topic for a common purpose that everybody can use it. I'm working for Accenture as a senior consultant. I'm also an OpenSUSE contributor, therefore I have added my open source, the same as my company email address here. Firstly, I will give you an overview about open source intelligence, what it is when we are coming to open source intelligence data versus non-OSINT data. These data will be used for cyber threat intelligence with cyber threat attribution then. I found a nice open source format, the structured threat expression, which will be used today mostly. From there, I will explain the threat score calculation in cyber for cyber security, how that will be used. Afterwards, we will come to an example with an energy cloud environment, how you can use it with multiple networks for scanning an enterprise environment as an example. Afterwards, we will add AI into this topic. We will speak about edge intelligence because this energy cloud environment is also an edge computing environment. We will use federated learning for AI, and then we want to have all data also secure. Therefore, I have added homomorphic encryption here. Before, I have added it together with federated learning. After the question by the professor, how is homomorphic encryption working? I have added an additional slide about that. And then there is the idea in the room to establish a central server on the global level for the common purpose with quantum computing. That is really new since last year. About myself, I'm a student with work experience, therefore I have learned the computer science expert for system integration, worked as a Linux system administrator, then I have received the Bachelor of Science by the Technische Hochschule Nürnberg, wrote my bachelor thesis at IBM, and now I'm doing my master besides the job in part-time. I'm allowed to go to conferences. I'm working as a senior consultant at Accenture in the IT/OT area. But at the moment, I am also working as part of our acquisition company, ESR Labs, at Accenture as a Linux release manager in the automotive area. Because of my open source career, with my OpenSUSE background, I'm the OpenSUSE release engineer for S390X. I'm leading our OpenSUSE C systems team, where I'm educating also our new people. I'm doing packaging things. I'm also the founder of the Linux distribution working group at the Open Mainframe project. Therefore, I'm allowed to speak for all Linux distributions on the mainframe to IBM as a co-chair. And yes, I have got multiple ambassador roles. When we are coming to the topic, open source intelligence is defined as the foundation of multiple intelligence areas. It provides the opportunity to watch all from the outside to identify relevant threats in a network. Some people are calling it also hardware hacking, and yes, you can collect, analyze, and use open source data. Open source data are public accessible data. You can use it from social media, all what is available public around. OSINT tools are designed based on the OSINT cycle. I have created this nice picture for that, how such a process to analyze open source data or OSINT data should be done. We have got four phases: data collection, data processing, analysis, and intelligence dissemination. At first, you want to know which data you have got, that is raw information data, you are collecting the data. Then you are coming into the next phase for data processing. These data are open source information then, OSINT. You are processing this data, I can do that and that with that. Then this data will be analyzed. In this process, we have got compiled data, and we are coming to the verified OSINT phase, where we can use this data as information, interact. We are receiving reports in the fourth step with intelligence dissemination, index, act as a cyber threat in cyber professionals, and give feedback what should be done afterwards. Open source intelligence data are public available data. They can be accessed without authorization, and you can receive this data structured and unstructured. Unstructured data have to be converted to structured data afterwards. We will see that later. And there are different public security databases available. The most well-known one is the CVE database, I have to say. And non-OSINT data are confidential data. Therefore, you don't want to have your personal data from the company or from banks public available. That's confidential. And these ones have to be saved within companies and organizations. Therefore, that shouldn't be used and public available then. We want to use this data, the OSINT data, for cyber threat intelligence. Lee has got the definition that it is the process and product resulting from an interpretation of raw data into information that meets a requirement as it relates to the adversaries that have the intent, opportunity, and capability to do harm. So we are receiving valuable insights into potential cyber threats and attacks, and we are using the process of using the information we can receive to understand the threats towards an organization. Our goal is to detect possible incidents and to prepare our environment that we are protected. Therefore, we are using all the tools here, and you will receive an overview of what has been established in the last years there. But we want, I told already, we want to structure our data. Therefore, we need information about where, why, and how an attack has happened. That all can be collected, and afterwards we can identify easier what an attacker wanted to achieve. Therefore, we are receiving information perhaps about the direction, timestamps, and goals. That all can be collected, and we want to use it also to prevent future attacks. And for AI later, we want to convert these unstructured and structured data to intelligence then. There are different indicators of compromise, high-level IOCs and low-level IOCs. Top priority everywhere is if we have got malware in our network, or we receive information about tactics and techniques, how an attacker has achieved that. Low-level IOCs are information like URLs, hashes, domain names, timestamps, and IP addresses. The reason is that is nice information that I know the attacker, but I don't know directly how I can prevent that, perhaps with exception of blocking or something like that. These then are in the cyber threat attribution. There are also four attribute groups available: the network address, file hash, file name, and other info. I've found also with structured threat intelligence expression, short STIX, written, that is maintained by the OASIS consortium on GitHub. And on this way, we can save all this cyber threat intelligence information in a machine and human readable format as JSON. It is afterwards, it is also usable for machine processing automation, and you can extend it also for multiple CTI platforms. I found the example with the enriched threat intelligence platform, ETIP, that is well known, and there are multiple research papers available, and it supports four cyber threat use cases: the analyzing of cyber threats, the specification of indicator patterns. You can manage response activities on the report level that you can decide what you want to do, and you can share the CTI information afterwards. The open source information, the threat attributes, is categorized as STIX domain objects, short SDOs. We will come to that on the next slide. So we are covering also the OSINT cycle with that. And the STIX is developed together with Taxi now on GitHub. That is the trusted automation exchange of intelligence information. So you can automate, use the STIX automation automated in Taxi now. And you can automate it. The process. One example platform using which is used with STIX and Taxi is MISP, the malware information sharing platform, which is also really established already. STIX domain objects, I said already, we want to structure that all. Here we are receiving information about the threat actor, the campaign which has been applied, recommendations with course of actions, what the cyber professionals should do, the exploit target, whether any system, any device, software, or network was the target, the incident, the indicator that is a pattern for cyber attacks, what has happened, and then we are receiving tactics, techniques, and procedures, what has been done, observer builds, which is also a special object within the STIX domain objects, the cyber observable objects to share this information afterwards, and other SDOs are attack patterns, infrastructure, location, malware analysis, any special information additionally with notes, opinions, and everything else. That all can be calculated together as a threat score. I explained before the indicators of compromise with a different priority level. Here we will add it. We are using the threat score also as an IOC within CTI. Therefore, we have to evaluate the threat data, use information about log files, databases, IP addresses, whether it is a CVE or not. CVE is one, not is zero as an example. And then we have to build the sum of the heuristic value together with the weight factor. Every heuristic information has got a weight factor from 0 until 5, as an example. And that will be multiplied together with with empty features through all features. Therefore, we are using all features which can happen and using the difference there. And yes, the hints are really low priority as a thread has got 0 until 1, medium priority 2 until 3, a high priority 3 until 4, and really critical for an action by cyber security professionals is a 5. Here is an example how such a CTI environment can be built. We have got multiple data centers with edge computing devices, therefore sensors and everything else, and smart meters can send data to the station level layer with the local CTI server for the special data center. The local CTI server is comparing that all this information, is all okay or not, or can I identify any attack? If an attack is happening, the central CTI server in the cloud layer will be informed, and the professionals can know, oh, in our company is happening something, we should inform also the other data centers. The data can be sent to the other local CTI server, and then you can protect the whole environment. What we are doing here, that was an edge computing environment, is also edge AI, what we have heard today in the keynote shortly, or we can call it also edge intelligence, which is meaning we are using AI in cooperation with edge computing. I gave last year also a funny talk using mainframes in edge computing environments as an example. I say today you can add every device to edge computing environments, therefore edge intelligence can be applied everywhere today from my point of view. Therefore, I don't want to restrict it to IoT or sensors and everything else. You can apply it everywhere today. But the main objective of edge intelligence regarding cybersecurity is the SIA triad. Therefore, you want to confirm confidentiality, integrity, and availability. And it covers also information privacy applied by artificial intelligence algorithms or malfunctions in software. The advantage is also that we can automate the detection of cyber risks, and we can add cryptography to apply the guarantee of confidentiality. Here we are coming to federated learning, because machine learning is part of artificial intelligence, and we use federated learning for distributed learning. We have had it here in the energy cloud environment also. We are using different data centers. We want to share the CTI information with others, that the whole network can be protected if any device will be have got an attack. Therefore, we are using federated learning for distributed learning here. In my case, I will apply that next month during our lab days, the first time that we will use different embedded devices and want to apply that there. But in general, that is in online and incremental learning to learn from changed and adapted data. It is useful for CTI and edge intelligence. Here in the example, we can see a smartphone, a car, and Industry 4.0, and we can share with an aggregated model our data with the others, and if anything is happening, the central node can inform the other devices what is happening there. We are training with neuronal networks here across multiple participants. All these devices are participants, the same as with CTI servers. One researcher, Hao et al., have introduced privacy-enhanced federated learning for industrial artificial intelligence, which is based on this principle. Yes, this picture is by Campos et al. But how do we want to keep that all secure, that nothing is going to the outside? That was also the question by my professor. And yes, we are using homomorphic encryption. Homomorphic encryption gives us the benefit that all devices are assigned to the same secret and can read encrypted data without decrypting it first. Therefore, we send all the data through the network encrypted, and you cannot read it without the shared secret key. And it is providing also performance and fastness in our case, because the devices can receive the information without decrypting it. That is providing the protection of sensitive information within the network. We enhance data privacy with that. After it is giving us also the possibility that the cybersecurity professionals can vote secure and decide whether it should be published or not afterwards, and forward the information to the next network inside of a company, and we can apply this encrypted data within our own network. Then we are coming to the idea, what I really like, is that we should have a global central CTI server, not only within the company. Yes, we all want to have protected networks, but after an attack, you should share this information equally within CVE databases also. Therefore, Sun et al. Has suggested an open source threat intelligence publishing platform, short OSTIP. On this way, you can find issues and publish it equal as in a CVE database. These new findings can be converted then into machine-readable CTI records, and afterwards we have collected many, many, many data. In January, I have received a course about quantum computing in the company, and then I thought, how about using a quantum computer for this use case then? And then I found the idea by Dalvi et al. He is proposing using quantum computers as powerful and safe systems for solving complex problems for cyber threat intelligence. Therefore, such a global central server with a quantum computer could be the solution for our problem. Our benefits are that we can process the CTI data really fast. Quantum computers can structure really fast, and we can provide the required data for pulling them from the different companies on the world then. Then we are coming to the conclusion. Anyways, I started with a small idea for a benefit for all in the enterprise area, with a main focus on enterprise companies. And anyways, I have achieved an unexpected multidisciplinarity with that. Yes, OSINT data can be used for cyber threat intelligence, that has been also established. with six format has been released with additional security-related databases. I saw IBM as an example is contributing there also a lot. From my point of view, such enterprise IoT environments and also others, all enterprise environments, should receive the latest OSINT data about existing attacks, and if one is happening anywhere, others should be informed also about that, equal as I have got the experience with the mailing lists regarding security issues and everything else. And there is some research activity already related to CTI servers on a global level, and in the best case, we can find a quantum computing sponsor for CTI. Thank you for listening, and we are coming to the questions.
Do we have any reliable open source threat intelligence publishing platforms that you were mentioning like that?
At Red Hat, I don't know. I'm not from Red Hat. I know that IBM is contributing there a lot to this STIX format I have shown here. Therefore, here I have referenced the open source threat intelligence platforms. Taxi is for automating in a project together with STIX on GitHub. MISP has been established as based on STIX and Taxi. This ETIP is not from Red Hat and IBM, but that is also based on STIX, but I don't know anything related to that by Red Hat at the moment.
What I meant was the actual threat intelligence information that you would feed into the something like MISP.
What the question is whether anything is missing and.
What I meant was you mentioned the open source threat intelligence publishing platform, right? Which I understood as something that would publish the threat intelligence information within the format space or whatever.
Yes.
Could be used afterwards in something like MISP.
Right? Yes. I didn't see the question was whether anything like this OSTIPS would be already available as open source and available. That was a suggestion I have read. Until now, there is no such open source threat intelligence publishing platform available. The sponsorship is missing at the moment. And therefore, that is an idea in the room. And yes, with Dalvi et al. Was the next one I found with the quantum computer solution. But anyways, they are discussing in their research papers about the possibility of a global CTI server. And then, how can we apply so many data if we want to collect it. Therefore, that is an idea in the room, but not until now that it would be available. Yes?
As you mentioned, homomorphic encryption, do you know if it works with like standard, for example, ISH, or do you need to have like special algorithm?
You don't. You don't need special algorithm. You can use the default homomorphic encryption libraries, which are available, that is working equal to anywhere else. You have got your cyber threat intelligence network, and the CTI server is interacting as the server. And then you can receive all the information.
Okay.
That's an interesting question. If we want, if we have got the encrypted data and change it on the device, how we apply it with changed data. That's an interesting question. I didn't do it in such a deepness. In my research paper, I wrote only the first sentence about homomorphic encryption, and I said then homomorphic encryption would cover an own 10-page paper, but how can we apply it inside of this CTI environment, because you, anything can happen on a device that is correct. Therefore, we have to add this data and compare it and adapt this data. And we want to receive also the sticks format afterwards and all the information forwarded. That requires all the computations. I didn't go in such a detail with the homomorphic encryption, how it will be applied there. I didn't find also so much information regarding that in the papers I have used there. But anyway, that is a good point, what should be analyzed. Any other topics or questions? Yes?
Yes, I have a question, because like that's cool to think about like all the like technical infrastructure for sharing this open source intelligence. But like it's not a tricky question at all. Like I'm just, you know, like thinking like how to actually approach it. How to be sure that, you know, there is enough people to share this information and that the sources of this information are like credible? Because like in the open source world, like what really works is like there is, for example, OSS list for like publishing the found vulnerabilities in open source software, right? And that's cool. But like if you think about enterprises, they don't usually want to like publicly share the information about, you know, the attacks that they are suffering from, and so on and so on. So like, it works in a closed network. Like for example, a financial cert in a country A shares the information through the MISP with banks in the country A, right?
Because yes.
They have like some common interest. And, like,
yes, there's a common interest.
Yes, they are credible sources. They know each other. Like it's in their common business, right? And like I'm wondering, like how you would, you know, scale it so it works, you know, like within like, you know, like a wide community of like unrelated, you know, companies, organizations from like all over the world, and so on and so on. And like I'm not talking about the technical stuff, but like, you know, how to like actually encourage people to share this information and how to verify, you know, the credibility.
The question was, how can we encourage people to participate with sharing the information? One hint, this energy cloud architecture with CTI by Gong is using already a cloud-based CTI server. Therefore, that is also already available, but that's only for one company. And enterprise companies want to have all protected. Banks, as an example, they want to receive the data but are restricted to publish it. And therefore, who should be responsible for publishing such information? We had also such a topic during our software engineering camp in Erlangen, because there was a Siemens student who asked, how is it with middle companies? Can they receive all of this information? And then they don't have got the cybersecurity professionals. Therefore, we are restricted to companies and organizations who have got cybersecurity professionals and with that also CTI servers available as a first step. And then we have to encourage these companies to interact with the other companies via these central servers then. Thank you for joining. The time is over.